Check out this scenario. Person A, let's call her Alice, wants to send a message to person B, whom we'll call Bob. The message, well, let's just say it's kind of personal, something she only wants Bob to read. The problem is that Alice is, wisely, wary and suspects someone might be spying on them. And sure enough, somebody's lying in wait for any messages that might come along. Eve. If Alice sends something to Bob, Eve will intercept it and their privacy will be breached. What can Alice do to keep her message secret? She'll have to modify it so that only she and Bob can understand the contents and keep them confidential. She has to encrypt it. As it's a written message, Alice thinks that one way to do it might be by altering the alphabet. She could shift all the letters a certain number of times, take the letters from the new alphabet, and replace them with the ones in the original text. Alice will have rewritten the message, encrypted it, and all she'll have to do is send the message to Bob in gibberish so that he, in private, can return it to its original state. In other words, decrypt and read it. And of course, Bob has to know how many times Alice shifted the alphabet in order to decipher it. Bob needs to know the key. The key is essential. Even if Eve intercepts the message and knows what kind of code they're using, without the key, she can't read it. This all sounds great to Bob, but Alice sees two major problems. The first is that Bob needs the key. He has to know how many times he's got to shift the alphabet, which means Alice must get it to him somehow. If Eve gets a hold of it, game over. The real danger is that Eve might intercept the key without Bob or Alice realizing that a third person knows it. They'd think they have a secure channel of communication when in fact, Eve has installed a bug and can spy on them whenever she wants. And problem two, Eve may have a lot of free time on her hands and try to decrypt the message by testing every possible shift until she gets a coherent message. Even without knowing the key, Eve can break the code by brute force. In this specific case, Eve only has to try around 25 combinations. If she has a computer, it's child's play. Alice and Bob need something more sophisticated. Alice does some research and finds an anti-espionage method that looks pretty foolproof, called one-time pad encryption. It works like this. She and Bob have two identical notepads where each page is filled with totally random numbers, a book of keys. To encrypt the message, Alice selects a page and shifts each letter in her message the number of times indicated on that page until she reaches the end. Alice then sends the encrypted message to Bob, and he just has to use the same page to shift the text back in the opposite direction and decrypt it. When they're done, Alice and Bob burn that page. It's only good for one use. If Eve intercepts the message, not only will she not understand a thing, but she'll also find it impossible to decipher the original text. The key literally could have modified the message in a gazillion ways. So if Eve wanted to try every possible combination using brute force, she'd have to check every possible message that could be written using those letters, including perfectly coherent messages that Eve wouldn't be able to distinguish from the original. Alice and Bob's privacy is safe. Bob starts preparing the pads to send one to Alice, but suddenly she realizes there's a flaw in their plan. What if Eve gets her hands on a copy of the pad? Plus, Alice has to tell Bob which page she used as the key. What if Eve intercepts it? The key is too vulnerable. They have to find a 100% foolproof solution. Then Alice remembers a video she saw about qubits and their properties. It's said that measuring in the quantum world has dire consequences, that the state of a qubit changes as soon as someone measures it. What if they used that property to create the key for their messages? In this quantum encryption protocol called BB84, in honor of its creators, an ultra-secure key is generated in binary code that she can use to encrypt her message. Listen up, this is a super smart solution. First, Alice generates a very long sequence of randomly selected bits and rewrites it as a string of qubits. In order to implement every value of the sequence in each qubit, Alice must decide whether to encode it on the x-axis or the z-axis. If she chooses the x-axis, Alice translates the zero bits by preparing what are called write states. while the 1 bits are translated by preparing left states. If she goes with the z-axis, Alice translates the 0 and 1 values by preparing states for each, also called 0 and 1. In other words, Alice's choices generate a qubit string with 4 possible states: 0, 1, right, or left. For each qubit, Alice records its state by indicating which axis she prepared it on and the value of the bit it represents. Once the string is long enough, she sends it to Bob. Bob takes each qubit that Alice has sent and randomly chooses an axis to measure it, X or Z. As you know from the previous video, if Bob measures on the same axis Alice chose, he has a 100% probability of accurately measuring his friend's preparation. Wink, wink. However, if he chooses the other axis, the state prepared by Alice will be projected on that axis, destroying it, and the result will be totally random. For example, if Alice prepared that qubit in a right state, in other words, on the x-axis, and Bob also decided to measure it on the x-axis, he'll undoubtedly measure right. But if he chooses to measure on the z-axis, the result will be a randomly plotted 0 or 1. In this way, Bob measures the entire string, jotting down the axis on which he decided to measure each qubit and the result he obtained, without knowing how Alice prepared the qubits. When he's finished, Bob takes the axes on which he measured Alice's qubits and posts them publicly. But only the axes, the results of each qubit, are kept confidential. When she sees this, Alice does the same. She takes only the axes on which she prepared each qubit and posts them. Eve sees these posts but doesn't really get what they're doing. The protocol continues. Now Alice and Bob compare the 2 lists of axes and eliminate the cases where the axes don't match. They do this because in these cases, the results Bob measures are totally random. For instance, imagine Alice prepares a left state on axis X, but Bob goes and measures it on axis Z. He'd randomly get a 0 or 1 state. No information has been transmitted. However, if Bob has chosen the same axis as Alice, in this case, X, he definitely would have measured a left state. When Alice and Bob choose the same axis, they always get the same result. They're exchanging a classic bit. Bob has a 50% chance of choosing the same axis as Alice, so the initial list of qubits will be reduced by about half. Okay, once they've purged the list, Alice asks Bob to post the results of a certain number of qubits. Bob posts them and Alice compares them with hers. Normally, Alice would see the exact same results on both charts. The bits she prepared are the same as the ones Bob measured. However, it could be that one of Bob's results doesn't match. Alice would find this puzzling. Maybe something went wrong with the connection, the preparation of the qubit, or Bob's measuring device. Just a glitch. Or maybe it's a sign that someone's been spying on them. Imagine that Eve, trying to get the key, has been intercepting the qubits that Alice sent to Bob, measuring them herself, and then sending them on to Bob as if nothing had happened. But unfortunately for Eve, thanks to the nature of the quantum world, in doing so, she's left her fingerprints on the qubits. Let's see an example. Alice prepares a qubit in 0 state and sends it to Bob, but Eve intercepts it before it reaches him. Eve doesn't know the qubit's initial state, so she can try to figure it out in one of the 2 ways. Measure it on the x-axis or on the z-axis. If Eve gets it right and measures on z, she'll obtain the value Alice wanted to send, and the qubit will remain as it was. Her action will go unnoticed. But if Eve gets it wrong and measures on the x-axis, the 0 state will randomly be plotted as a left or right state. Let's assume it goes right. Get this, Eve has destroyed the initial state in which Alice prepared the qubit, and she doesn't even know it. She can't tell if Alice sent the qubit that way, or if she was the one who altered it. Not wanting the couple to get suspicious, Eve sends the qubit on to Bob. Now Bob, unaware of what Eve has done, has chosen which axis to measure it on. If Bob chooses X, Eve can breathe a sigh of relief. When he and Alice compare their results, that one will be eliminated because their axes don't match, and Eve's action goes unnoticed. But if Bob decides to measure the qubit on the z-axis, when they compare axes, they'll mark it as correct and keep it on the list. Now Eve's in hot water. By measuring the right state on the z-axis, Bob will obtain one of two possible states, 0 or 1. If it's 0, Eve's in the clear. Alice will see that she prepared that qubit in 0 state, and Bob measured it in 0 state. So far, so good. Eve's devious tricks won't show up in the results. But if Bob happens to get a 1, trouble. Alice will see that she prepared a 0 state and Bob measured a 1 state, which is impossible. On axis Z, Bob had a 100% probability of measuring 0, and so Alice discovers that someone's been poking their nose into her qubits and that her communication channel has been compromised. Alice hits the abort button and throws away the key she'd come up with. Both she and Bob leave the protocol for another time when they'll start from scratch, and Eve's left to fume over her thwarted plans. As you've seen in this case, Alice busts Eve, but there will be other times when Eve's eavesdropping goes undetected. Look, maybe Eve's axis coincides with Alice's. Her measurement doesn't affect the qubit, and nobody would ever know she'd measured it. Or maybe her axis doesn't match Alice's, but Bob's doesn't either. Bob and Alice would strike that measurement and never pick up on Eve's interference. Even if her axis doesn't match Alice's and Bob's does, maybe Eve will get lucky and Bob will recover the original state in his plotting. It would be like nothing had happened, and Eve would be safe. Now, you're probably thinking that the odds are in Eve's favor and this protocol is kind of crappy. But remember, Eve has to do this with every single qubit. In other words, on every qubit Alice decides to check, Eve is taking a risk, and it'll only take a couple of errors for Alice to become suspicious and abort the protocol. I'll give you the numbers. The probability of Eve making a mistake and Alice busting her is 25% if, of course, Alice only asks Bob to send her one qubit for verification. If she checks 10 qubits, the probability increases to 95%. With 50, Alice's odds go up to 99.9999%. To put it another way, if Alice checks 10 qubits, Eve's chances of getting off scot-free are the same as the odds of tossing 4 coins into the air and having them all come up heads. If Alice selects 50 qubits, that's 20 coins. In short, spying on these two isn't worth the risk for Eve. If Alice checks enough qubits and doesn't see any errors, she can be certain that only she and Bob touched the string she sent. They're secure data that only she and Bob know. So, to conclude the process, Alice tells Bob that everything came up Milhouse, and they can use the rest of the results they didn't make public as a key. Working independently, Alice and Bob take the bit sequence and convert it from the binary system to the decimal system. They've created a one-time pad page. Alice just has to shift each letter in her message the number of times indicated on the page, and when Bob receives the message, he does the same in reverse. No leaks, no chance of someone breaking the code by brute force, and the confidence of knowing that nobody's spying on them. Quantum cryptography saved the day. And yeah, I know some of you are thinking this is too complicated, that no one in their right mind would spend so much time just to get a nude pic. The thing is, Alice and Bob could use polarized photons as qubits and delegate all the hard work of this protocol to a couple of machines, which can complete the entire process in a matter of seconds. They can even repeat it as many times as necessary to confirm that the key is secure. Actually, this isn't a fantasy anymore. If you want, right now you can go online and buy a device with a similar protocol. Quantum technology is already a reality, peeps. What's more, this is the simplest thing you can do with quantum physics. Once you resort to the bizarre phenomenon of entanglement, even the wildest telecom dreams seem to come true. But that's a topic for another video. And remember, if you want more science, just hit the subscribe button. Thanks for watching.